Excited to be here and talk a little bit about Arbitrum Orbit. So what is Arbitrum Orbit? You're probably pretty familiar with Arbitrum 1 and Arbitrum Nova, which have been live for quite a while now. Arbitrum 1, obviously, lot going on, but there's a very general piece of technology that's behind those chains. And what Arbitrum Orbit is the ability to use that same technology in order to permissionlessly launch chains as L3s on top of Arbitrum 1 or Arbitrum Nova, which opens up a huge area of possible weird, new, cool designs that people can work on. So what does an Orbit chain actually look like? Well, I'm not going to go into all the details here, but the cool part is basically to describe what an Orbit chain looks like. I just took the diagram I used to describe what Arbitrum 1 looks like, and I changed where it says L2 to say L3, and where it says L1 to say L2. And that's how cool Orbit is, because it's just reusing the same built tech that has the experience and the security and the usability from Arbitrum 1 to deploy other chains. So to dig into like a little bit what that means, the way Arbitrum works is, generally speaking, there's a set of smart contracts. The way Arbitrum 1 works is there's a set of smart contracts that are on Ethereum. We call the roll-up smart contracts, also the bridge smart contracts. And those allow for the security and communication between, for example, Ethereum and Arbitrum 1. And so for an Arbitrum Orbit chain, those same contracts with some relatively minor modifications are deployed to Arbitrum 1 in order to support an L3 chain on top of it, along with some changes in the node in order to add support here. And so kind of there's a question here of like, what are the challenges? Was it as simple as just deploying it directly and having kind of the exact same software work as is? Not quite, but almost. There's a little bit. Arbitrum block numbers, I don't know if people are familiar, work a little bit differently than Ethereum block numbers. And so there was a bit to do around there, but it really was almost as simple as just taking the existing code along with lots and lots of renaming, because there's a lot of places where we say L2 and L1, which now have to be a little generalized out now that there are multiple layers that an Arbitrum chain could be deployed at. So why would you want to have this whole separate chain if you could just deploy on an existing one? So the number of different pretty cool advantages to having your own chain that we think are going to be really interesting for protocols to explore. And I'm just going to go through a few today. So one kind of pretty out there interesting one is the fact that you can arbitrarily customize the software to do whatever you want. So Arbitrum 1 very much has kind of been guided by Ethereum compatibility and EVM equivalence, and has tried to kind of be very in line with what the experience looks like. But that's by no means has to be true for an Orbit chain, which is just using the tech and can do whatever it wants. And so you can really get in there and actually start to think through, are there customizations for your protocol, for your project, that would be interesting to do at the state transition, at the real kind of core of the chain level? And so just sort of naming a few interesting ones here, just that kind of seem like candidates it could be fun. One, native account abstraction and actually integrating smart contract wallets into the chain might break compatibility with some things, but also is super powered and allows you to kind of enable experiences that are just not possible on Ethereum or Arbitrum 1 today. EIP 1153, which some people may have heard of because it was relatively contentious for whether or not Ethereum would adopt it in the last hard fork. It's the PR called transient storage, which Uniswap V4 is looking for in order to be as cheap as it's going to be. SECP 256R1, which is a mouthful, but which has the really cool property of being that the curve that iPhones and I think also Android phones use when you, for example, use Face ID. And so it would enable all sorts of kind of decentralized use cases where you could actually have Face ID be your private key in a really cool way. Access control being another one, if you want to have kind of various portions of your chains permissioned and kind of have that enabled kind of whatever way you want. And then anything else you can think of, because this is not a list of like, these are the features it has that you can take advantage of. This is a list where it's, these are a few things that I thought were cool, but hopefully it will inspire many other ideas. So next one up would be gas price reliability. When you deploy on Arbitrum One, Arbitrum Nova, wherever else, the cost to your users is really at the whim of what other applications are there. Block space currently is relatively available on Arbitrum One, but that will change over time as demand grows. And Arbitrum Orbit Chains give you the ability to have a dedicated capacity for just your chain, just your application, so that you don't need to worry, well, what if there's some meme coin that launches and then suddenly the gas price 10x's for my users and nobody can use my dApp anymore? And if you really want to be able to hedge against that and avoid that, you can just have your own block space. And then finally, I think we have customized protocol logic. So I talked about sort of the state transition function, the logic of how blocks are executed. But the other side that you can mess with is going to be the actual core logic of the protocol. And again, I'm just giving kind of a few examples of sort of the immediate candidates of things that would be interesting. But I fully expect to see, as dev teams really jump into this and engage more, for them to go way beyond this. And so just sort of a few examples here being one, alternate data availability. Nova provides sort of one, Arbitrum AntiTrust provides one model for data availability that's used on Arbitrum Nova that I think is very powerful, but there are also a lot of other interesting models out there. So kind of, for example, and just kind of one example being like other chains, like for example, using Celestia for data availability is possible if you can customize the protocol logic. Building in your own governance system. Arbitrum One obviously has a particular governance system, but fundamentally, if you're launching your own Arbitrum chain, you can put in place whatever system you want. Messing with the challenge protocol itself, and this gets a little more out there, but like all the time in the crypto industry, I never believe that like anybody knows the best way to do something. So opening up the ability of teams to innovate and kind of advance the state of the art is really exciting. New forms of cross-chain communication. I think like everybody on Arbitrum is probably seen some of or certainly used, if they've bridged tokens, the L1 to L2 Arbitrum using retriables, and then back to Ethereum, where we have a utility for that too. It's definitely like it works quite well in practice, but it's certainly one possible design that isn't perfect for every application. And so I could definitely imagine a large amount of innovation going on for particular applications doing exactly what they need to be able to do to relate back to the underlying chain and communicate correctly. And then finally, alternate sequencing models. There's a huge amount of innovation going on right now when it comes to sequencing. Different approaches. There's kind of shared sequencing, distributed sequencing. There's a million different kind of sequencing models out there that people are exploring. And if you have your own chain, you can plug in whatever model you want. So that's great and all, but why launch an L3 and not an L2? Obviously, kind of an L3, you're stacking up more layers, you're on top of Arbitrum One. You might compare that, obviously, to just launching a chain on the same level as Arbitrum One, inheriting directly from Ethereum. But there are a number of really cool reasons why you actually really probably want an L3 chain specifically. So one interesting one, Finality Speed. And this gets a little bit into the kind of technical details, but generally speaking, way rollups work. You send your transaction to the sequencer. The sequencer then collects a bunch of transactions together into a batch and posts that batch to Ethereum. So that's an Ethereum transaction then. And when that transaction on Ethereum is final, that's when your Arbitrum transaction actually has finality. Now, posting a batch has fixed costs associated. So it's not just paying for the data for your transaction. There's also kind of various other costs involved. And what you want to do there then, and what's kind of optimal and what Arbitrum None does, is amortize. So there are fixed costs. There are also a lot of user transactions. If we divide those costs over a large number of user transactions, they basically don't matter at all. So what if you have what if you have your own chain and there just isn't that much usage? Then you're faced with the trade-off of either posting often still and having much more expensive transactions, or posting way less often and having way slower finality. Whereas if you're hosting at L3, you don't have that same trade-off anywhere near as much, because those same fixed costs, which are very expensive on Ethereum, will be way cheaper on Arbitrum. And so you can get by and kind of effectively have way less usage on your L3 and still have having your own rollup chain be a big advantage. And that will be a big enabler, because as teams are thinking about launching, they don't know exactly how much traffic they're get. They don't know exactly how adoption will look and what the time to actually kind of, I mean, people believe in their projects, obviously, but the crypto industry is a bit of a roller coaster. So you never really want to assume that you're suddenly going to be able to get enough traffic to actually fill up batches quickly. So next up, we have accessibility of Stylus. So Stylus, you heard about earlier. Hopefully people are very excited about that. And when you have Stylus on the underlying chain, so where the rollup smart contracts are deployed, you're going to be able to do some really interesting things. Stylus provides so many capabilities that you can take advantage of for the protocol that you're really going to be able to innovate here. And I think we'll see over time that L3 chains start to look much, much, much more advanced than L2 chains, which are limited by what they can do on Ethereum. And so just kind of one sort of fun example here is the way the outbox is implemented. So when you do a withdrawal from Arbitrum to Ethereum today, what happens is there's a big Merkle tree that's built up, and it's periodically, the root of it is posted back to Ethereum. And then when you actually execute your withdrawal, you have to put a proof that your actual withdrawal is inside that Merkle tree, which is pretty expensive. Merkle trees, some people may have heard of that they're kind of one of the big areas that Ethereum is looking at in order to make this same style of proving cheaper. And those will require various primitives that aren't really feasible on Ethereum and the EVM itself, but will be accessible with Stylus. And I think that's just one example. And because kind of Stylus is obviously like very, very new so far, I think we're only scratching the surface of the cool changes that are going to be enabled for L3s using it. And then last, but certainly not least, making transactions on Ethereum is much more expensive than Arbitrum 1. Generally speaking, when it comes to kind of dedicated dApp-specific chains, the expectation is probably going to be that users, there's a lot of activity that's going to onboard through the underlying chain. You're not probably going to get direct exchange support for your L3 itself. You're instead going to ask users to onboard and then bridge. And having users go through Ethereum is potentially going to be quite expensive. And I think for people who've kind of been in this space long enough, they'll remember that Ethereum fees are pretty cheap right now. They're still more expensive they're a lot more expensive than Arbitrum, but they have been much higher, and they probably will be much higher. And being able to have a user experience that doesn't require users to interact with Ethereum and allows them to just kind of have a purely Arbitrum native experience is going to be really powerful. So by now, you're all completely convinced. Everybody in this room wants their own Orbit chain. So now I get to talk a little bit about how you can have that. So a few weeks ago now, I think it was a few weeks ago, but time is always a bit of a blur, we released a tool that allows anybody to launch their own Orbit chain on testnet. And this tool, you visit it in your browser, you go through a very simple flow. It deploys the rollup chain contracts. It also lets you download a configuration file to feed into the node to run a node. And then you are completely locally running the entirety of the infrastructure needed in order to have an Orbit chain. So there's nothing going on outside of what you're actually doing on your computer, which is running a real Orbit chain on top of Arbitrum Gorilla. And that's something you can do today. And would definitely highly recommend that people check it out, since it's a very quick process, and it's really cool how powerful it is. And so what you can do with that, so you can launch your chain, you can leave it at all defaults, but you can also customize. And this kind of starts to scratch the surface of why Orbit is cool. You don't need to go with the defaults. You don't need to go with the choices made for Arbitrum 1. You can instead take a whole set of parameters and customize it specifically for your chain. You can run all of it. You can run all of it yourself. You don't have to trust anybody. You don't need to trust me at all. All the code is completely open, and you can see everything. And we're going to be continuously expanding this tool out so that dev teams can kind of feel the power and be able to experience sort of what it's like to work with a chain themselves without needing to talk to anybody, without needing any kind of support, just completely a fully local experience. And we're going to be adding kind of, I think, the next two big features that we're going to be adding here, which are going to be pretty exciting to have. One is that currently only roll-up chains are supported through this, and we're adding support for any trust chains as well. And the other is one that I know is very exciting to a lot of dev teams, just because it's a real enabler, which will be the ability on any trust chains to use a token other than ETH as your fee token. And so projects will, for example, be able to use their token as the fee token on their chain, which is going to be a really powerful enabler. So when mainnet, when is this actually going to be kind of in everybody's hands? I was describing right now, we have this tool, it's on testnet, and kind of you can use it today. But when is it going to actually be sort of in production? And I think the answer is definitely quite soon. As I was describing, the set of changes kind of for Orbit on top of the existing system are quite minor. And so it's definitely an experience that kind of, it's definitely something that's not a whole large, complex new piece of technology. It very much just bootstraps off of the trust and security that Arbitrum already has. They're an exciting number. And I think we'll be hearing from one later today of dedicated roll-up as a service companies that are helping teams to actually launch and manage production chains. And we're working with a number of them to add support for Arbitrum, which, as I was describing, you can run everything yourself locally, but you might not want to for a production chain unless you have an entire DevOps team already. And so there are going to be a number of service providers that are going to make this experience much, much easier and kind of one click even for full production setup. But if you want, you can do everything yourself. There's no dependency on, you can, without ever talking to anybody, have a production mainnet chain that is kind of fully supported. And so I would definitely recommend that kind of anybody who's interested in this should start working on this today. It's super easy to get started, and it's a pretty powerful experience. And just to wrap up, how do you actually decide? Like, there's a lot here. It sounds interesting, but there's also a lot of complexity and it's new. So how do you think through kind of, is this something that actually is the right decision? Because there are very much real trade-offs in doing this. One big one is that certainly kind of we're very used to on Ethereum, on Arbitrum One, having a lot of ecosystem support for various tooling. The blockchain world is not yet completely ready for the idea of there being many chains. There are a large number of services that people depend on, which kind of do not arbitrarily scale out to a large number of chains. I think this will change over time probably, but it's certainly kind of a pretty big pivot. And so I think for quite a while, that will probably be sort of a pain point of smaller projects, especially who are adopting this. Another is interoperability, in that like Orbit chains will have interoperability, but they won't have the same level of synchronous composability that you get being on a single chain. You won't be able to just atomically in a single transaction call out to contracts on Arbitrum One. And so if your project depends on kind of directly composing and building on top of other building blocks that are already on Arbitrum One, then you'll need to think through, is there a way that this can be designed that uses the asynchronous communication between chains as opposed to the synchronous one within a single chain? And then kind of last but not least, like fundamentally, I went through in this talk essentially kind of the characteristics of the chain that make it appealing, that make it interesting, make it useful. And so I would say very much that like, if one of those features is kind of interesting and exciting to you, it's very much something that you should check out. If none of them are, then you very well might want to kind of just deploy to Arbitrum One, which is still a kind of great experience that hopefully a lot of people here today have used and enjoyed and hopefully maybe deployed code on and is very much not going anywhere. So with that, I will say thank you very much for listening and hope you're having a good day.